The Conjuring: The Devil Made Me Do It is the third installment in the main Conjuring series, which began in 2013. It's the eighth installment in the overall franchise, which includes films like The Nun and Annabelle. As with the first two Conjuring films, The Conjuring: The Devil Made Me Do It also claims to be inspired by a true story. The real-life events unfolded in the early 1980s and began with a 12-year-old boy named David Glatzel. David had been helping his sister Debbie and her fiancé Arne Cheyenne Johnson clean up a rental property they were about to move into. David claimed to have encountered an old man who pushed him and said that he would bring harm to them if they moved into the Connecticut home. After David returned to his mother's home, he said that he continued to see the old man who talked to him. The man now had dark eyes and animal-like features. David had night terrors, and he had obtained unexplained scratches and bruising on his body. It was then that the family brought in a Catholic priest to bless the house, and they also called self-proclaimed demonologists Ed and Lorraine Warren, who were portrayed by Patrick Wilson and Vera Farmiga in the films. Lorraine Warren claimed that she saw a black mist materialize next to David, indicating that the demon was present. She also claimed that she saw David being choked by invisible hands and that red marks could be seen on his neck afterward. She said that he growled and hissed and spoke in unrecognizable voices, and that he would recite passages from the Bible and John Milton's Paradise Lost. Ed and Lorraine Warren oversaw three exorcisms that David was subjected to. Lorraine Warren claimed that David levitated, ceased breathing, and even foreshadowed the murder that was to come. During one of the exorcisms, David's sister's fiancé, Arne Johnson, egged on one of the demons to leave David's body and possess him instead. A few days later, after David's condition improved, Arne began to show signs that the demon had taken hold of him. Arne claimed that the demon took control of his car and forced it into a tree. He claimed that his final lucid encounter with the demon was at the rental home when he was examining an old well which had supposedly housed the demon. He believed that he had truly become possessed when he made eye contact with the demon at the well. By this point, Arne Johnson and Debbie Glatzel had decided against renting the home, and they had begun renting an apartment near her place of employment in Brookfield, Connecticut. Debbie had been working as a dog groomer for the landlord of the apartment, a man by the name of Alan Bono. On February 16, 1981, Arne Johnson called in sick to the tree service where he worked. Instead, he met Debbie at the kennel where she worked, and her boss, Alan Bono, took them both to a local bar for lunch. Now, by this point, Arne Johnson had supposedly been exhibiting strange behavior that was similar to that of Debbie's younger brother, David. At least that's what was claimed at his trial. While at lunch, their landlord and Debbie's boss, Alan Bono, had begun to drink heavily. By the time they returned to the kennel, Alan Bono was intoxicated. He grabbed a hold of Debbie's 9-year-old cousin Mary and refused to let go. Arne Johnson ordered Bono to release Mary, and when he finally did, the two men continued to argue. Debbie attempted to stand between the two men, and Wanda tried to pull her brother Arne away. According to what was stated at the trial, Arne then began to growl like an animal and pull out a 5-inch pocket knife and stab Bono repeatedly. According to Arne Johnson's lawyer, Bono had suffered 4 to 5 tremendous wounds, mainly to his chest. Bono would die at the hospital several hours later. It had become the first murder in the history of Brookfield, Connecticut. At the trial, Arne Johnson's lawyer, Martin Minella, attempted to enter a plea of not guilty due to demonic possession. Minella argued that Arne Johnson had killed Alan Bono while under the devil's spell. It was the first known court case in the United States where the defense had sought to prove innocence based on a claim of demonic possession. As word of the defense spread to the media, the trial had become known as the Devil Made Me Do It case, hence the film's title. The presiding judge in the case, Robert Callahan, promptly rejected the idea of a defense based on demonic possession. Callahan stated that no such defense could ever exist in a court of law due to a lack of evidence. He stated that it would be irrelative and unscientific to allow testimony related to such a defense. Arne Johnson's lawyer, Martin Minella, had to give up the argument of demonic possession and instead chose to imply that Johnson acted in self-defense. The jury deliberated for 15 hours over the course of 3 days, and on November 24th, 1981, Arne Cheyenne Johnson was convicted of first-degree manslaughter and was sentenced to 10 to 20 years in prison. While in prison, Arne Johnson married Debbie Glatzel. He also received his high school diploma and took a number of college courses. He was a model prisoner and was released on good behavior after serving less than 5 years in prison. So that's the premise of the true story behind The Conjuring, The Devil Made Me Do It. But were David Glatzel and Arne Johnson actually possessed? Obviously, there's a great deal of doubt around this. And as with Ed and Lorraine Warren's other cases, which included the Amityville Horror case and the other Conjuring cases, they here too have been accused of manufacturing the case for financial gain. In fact, Lorraine Warren was involved in a 1983 book about the case called The Devil in Connecticut. It's by no means the only time that the Warrens had profited from books about their cases. A 1983 television movie was also made about the possession and the trial. It was called The Demon Murder Case, and it aired on NBC. It starred Kevin Bacon, Andy Griffith, and Cloris Leachman. Further bringing doubt to what's depicted in The Conjuring, The Devil Made Me Do It, is the fact that the young boy, David Glatzel, has never publicly confirmed what happened to him. Other family members, including David's brother Carl Glatzel, spoke out against the book when it was republished in 2006. Carl called the book a complete lie, saying that the Warrens concocted a phony story about demons in an attempt to get rich and famous at our expense. Carl said that his younger brother David had been suffering from a mental illness at the time, from which he has since recovered. He said that the entire family was manipulated and exploited by Ed and Lorraine Warren. Carl filed a lawsuit against the book's author, Gerald Brittle, and the Warrens for unspecified financial damages. Brittle claimed that his book is based entirely on fact and that he spent more than 100 hours interviewing the Glatzel family. As for Lorraine Warren, she says that the six priests who participated in the exorcisms all agreed that David Glatzel was possessed. Both the author Brittle and Lorraine Warren criticized the lawsuit and questioned Carl Glatzel's motive, with Brittle implying that it was for financial gain. But clearly, financial gain had been a motivating factor for the book's author Gerald Brittle and the Warrens. So let me know what you guys think in the comments. Do you think Ed and Lorraine Warren are scam artists? Do you think they actually believed that David Glatzel and Arne Johnson were possessed by demons? I'm interested to hear your thoughts on this case and the other Conjuring movies. If you're interested in learning more about the true stories behind the Conjuring movies, check out our articles over on historyvershollywood.com, which are linked in the description below. As always, if you enjoyed this video, hit that subscribe button. Anchors away, my friends.